All right, I think we are ready here. All right, good afternoon, everyone, and thank you all for joining us for today's A Month of Service presentation of Debt Collection and Your Rights. My name is Nia Murray. I am the Programs Coordinator with Neighborhood Recovery Community Development Corporation, and we are one of the partners in the A Month of Service collaboration. Also included is the City of Houston's Department of Neighborhoods. Also, on behalf of our presenting partner with the Houston Bar Association, we have Ms. Megan Deitch with the DH law firm, who's going to be giving the presentation today about debt collection. Also included in our partnership is Lone Star Legal Aid, the Earl Carl Institute, Harris Central Appraisal District, Houston Volunteer Lawyers, and the Harris County Tax Assessor Collector's Office. And together we all make up A Month of Service. And basically what A Month of Service is, it's a collaboration of all eight of our organizations. We come together on a monthly basis and offer a variety of different workshops and presentations relative to asset building and asset protection, community empowerment, and the maintaining of generational wealth. We used to do these kinds of presentations in person, but of course, due to COVID, we've had to adjust and adapt to the virtual platform, which actually has been an even better way for us to reach even more people throughout the Houston and Harris County communities, as well as surrounding counties throughout the state of Texas, across the country even, where people are able to tune in virtually to listen to the presentations that we have to offer to the community. We know that there are a lot of community residents that do not have access to a lot of information, that don't know where to go, don't know who to call, don't know what questions to ask when it comes to certain things. So we wanna try to create as large of an impact as we can and get as much information as we possibly can out to the communities that we do all serve. So we did decide to collaborate and come together to do just that. So this is an opportunity for you to talk with professionals relative to, again, asset building, asset protection, community empowerment, and the maintaining of generational wealth to help answer any questions that is that you may have. We have the volunteer attorney that is going to be presenting for you today. However, I just wanted to kind of keep you in mind that the information that is presented here today is for educational purposes only. It is not legal advice. However, we do encourage you to reach out to our legal service partners as well as to Ms. Deitch if you are interested in attaining the services of any of our legal service partners or our presenter here today. So with that being said, again, this is your opportunity to ask questions, but we try to ask that you keep your questions to be as general as you possibly can, as to not divulge any personal detail information about your personal situation to get out there as we are recording the session as well as presenting live on our virtual platform at Amos Houston TX on Facebook. So we want to try to protect your privacy as much as we possibly can. So we ask that you do keep those questions to be general. You can either type your questions into the chat and we'll get to them at the end of the presentation, or you can unmute yourself at the end and you can ask your questions directly. If you are, however, joining us on Facebook, please feel free to type your questions into the comment section and I'll make sure that I get those read aloud at the end of the presentation as well. So with that being said, we've got a lot of good information that's gonna be presented here today. I'm here taking notes and I hope you guys find the information to be beneficial and looking forward to it. So Ms. Megan, I'll have you introduce yourself and we'll get right on into our presentation.
Wonderful, thank you so much. So my name is Megan Deitch and I'm an attorney here in Houston. I have a law firm called DH Law, and we're actually all over the state of Texas, and we represent individuals who've been sued by creditors. So we do something called debt defense. We do also handle some Chapter 7 bankruptcy as well. So a lot of this I'm very familiar with, and I'm happy to answer questions along the way or at the end too. So I do have a presentation that I'm going to go ahead and pull up right now. Just want to make sure you can see the PowerPoint before I get started.
Yep, can we see it?
Perfect, great, okay. It's trying to pull up right now, I apologize. So today we are discussing your rights in debt collection. And so what rights do you have in debt collections? My guess is you probably have the wrong view. Do you all have the presenter view?
Correct.
Let me swap displays. Hopefully this will work. Good,
Yep.
good. Awesome. Okay, great, great. So here's what we're going to be talking about today. It is a lot of information. Hopefully we'll get through all of it. If not, again, opening up for questions. So we will start with the Fair Debt Collection Practices Act, kind of explain what it is and what rights and remedies you have under it. And then we'll go through everything else as well, or hopefully we can. So really sort of the importance of understanding your rights from a debtor's perspective. And again, that's all that I represent are debtors. So a couple of things that we will be learning today. The goal is really for everybody to become more educated about debtor rights during debt collections, as well as the importance of knowing your rights to protect yourself from abusive or unfair debt collection practices. We'll talk a little bit today about kind of what happens before there's a lawsuit, and then we'll discuss a little bit too once it's escalated and a debt is no longer in collections and it's actually become a lawsuit. Okay, so what is the Fair Debt Collection Practices Act? It is the FDCPA. It's a federal law designed to protect debtors from abusive or unfair practices by debt collectors. It establishes guidelines for ethical and legal debt collection. So it gives us guidelines for certain things such as prohibited practices for debt collectors. So as an example, and we'll get into more specific detail as well, debt collectors are prohibited from engaging in practices such as harassment, including repeated phone calls or using abusive language, false representation, which includes misrepresenting the amount owed, the creditor's identity, or the consequences of not paying the debt, and unfair practices such as threatening legal action without the intent to actually follow through. I know this is a lot of information here, but I wanted you to have some of the specifics as well. So as far as misrepresenting the amount that you owe, the debt collector is actually prohibited from asking you to pay any extra interest, fees, or expenses that are not allowed by law or stipulated as part of your debt agreement. They cannot add on any extra fees that your original credit or loan agreement doesn't allow simply because they feel like it. So essentially, they do have to refer to the terms and agreement that you originally entered into. Even if it's a credit card agreement, there will be certain terms that are outlined in a credit card agreement. Calling you repeatedly or continuously. Under the FDCPA, they consider repeated calls that are called in excess of 7 times a day and as harassment. So they're not allowed to exceed that number, which I know does seem harassing. It can be a lot of calls, unfortunately, but we're also going to talk about some ways you can kind of prevent or limit those calls. They're not allowed to use obscene, profane, or abusive language while over the phone with you. They can't insult, demean, abuse, or threaten you during an attempt to collect a debt. Doing so will be a violation of your FDCP rights and may entitle you to compensation. They're also not allowed to call before 8 a.m. or after 9 p.m. 8 a.m. is generally considered to be start of the business day or work day. So if they're calling you extremely early before the business day starts or before 8 a.m. or extremely late after the day ends, again, pursuant to what the FDCPA says, it would be 9 p.m., you may have a valid case of debt collector harassment. As far as calling at times that are inconvenient, if, for example, you're unable to receive calls while you're at work, you should let the debt collector know. Anytime you're letting the debt collector know anything, you can let them know over the phone if they call you, but also be sure to let them know in writing as well. It's really important to just track your communications with them and make sure that you're able to reference those documents and correspondence later on if you do end up needing to bring a case against them. One thing that's really important to note as well, they are not allowed to threaten to use violence, the courts, or the police. They can't threaten any violence against you or arrest or jail time. If that were to happen, you should report them immediately. And here's a phone number, which we can provide to you all later as well, that you could actually call to report them. One thing that I'm going to talk about a little bit more later on is sometimes, at least in the last couple of years, I've received a lot of calls from individuals and existing clients who say, well, the creditor's contacting me, but I'm not familiar with this debt amount. Or they're telling me that a police officer is coming after me or that I'm going to go to jail. I will tell you, in most of those instances, it has been a scam. I'm not saying it is always a scam, but I think that there's a higher or increased likelihood that if somebody is calling you and claiming to be a debt collector and they are threatening to send you to jail, that there is a good chance that this is not actually a creditor, that it may be a scam, and you should not provide any of your confidential or personal or private information to them. They also can't threaten an action that they cannot or will not take. So they can't threaten to sue or file charges against you, garnish wages, take your property, cause job loss, or ruin your credit when they cannot or do not intend to take the action. Doing so is a violation of your FDCPA rights. So a couple examples here. One is, and we'll talk about the statute of limitations more in a few minutes, if the debt is now outside of the applicable statute of limitations pursuant to what your law has determined the statute of limitations is, they cannot then threaten to file a lawsuit against you once that statute of limitations passes. Another example would be garnishing wages. In the state of Texas, creditors are not allowed to garnish wages. They can garnish bank accounts, though. So there is a subtle distinction. They cannot go to your employer and garnish wages before they hit your bank account. Once they hit your bank account, then they do have the opportunity and potentially the right to garnish those funds in your account, but they cannot contact your creditor and garnish those wages. Again, I'm talking about creditors and debt collection. I'm not talking about child support, though. So I just wanted to make a distinction there. They also are not allowed to inform a third party about your alleged debt, or at least there are certain third parties they're not allowed to. So unless you've given permission, they're not allowed to inform anyone about the existence of your status of your debt, except these are some of the parties or entities that they may be able to provide notice to or speak with. The original creditor, so if it is a debt collector or a third party debt buyer, they would have the ability and the right to speak with the original creditor about your debt. Your attorney, you have indicated that you're represented by legal counsel. They then would be able to speak with your attorney on your behalf. The creditor's attorney, if they are represented by counsel, they also have the right to share that information with their attorney. A credit reporting agency. There are certain agreements that a lot of creditors have, especially the original creditors, with the credit reporting agencies. And so they may actually have a duty to report to the credit bureaus. Your spouse or possibly a co-signer, and if you're under the age of 17, I'm sorry, 17 or possibly 18 or younger, then a parent or legal guardian. They're also not allowed, or they are prohibited from calling a third party or repeatedly calling a third party to get your location information. So typically, they can only contact a third party once unless they have reason to believe the information previously provided is false. So if you've provided false contact information for yourself, then they may make a repeated attempt. They're also not allowed to disclose the existence or status of your debt to a third party. So for instance, if they were to call your office or your work and try to verify your contact information, they cannot also disclose the existence or status of your debt to your office. They're also not allowed to ignore your written request to verify, excuse me, to verify the debt. A collector cannot proceed with collection efforts after you've sent a written request to dispute or verify the debt if the request was made within 30 days of the collector's written notice. So essentially, the way that this works is if you are contacted by a debt collector, and let's say you're unfamiliar with the debt, or you would like some sort of debt verification or validation to confirm that the debt is yours and to confirm the amount, you can request debt validation. It's best, again, to put all of this in writing. They then have 30 days to respond to that written request and provide you with debt validation or verification documents. Some of those documents could look like original statements, like credit card statements. If there was a promissory note that was signed, it could be the original agreement. And if it is a third-party debt buyer, then they would likely include a bill of sale or chain of title document showing that it was sold from original creditor A to debt buyer B. Continuing collection attempts before providing debt verification. After receiving your written dispute or request for further verification, also known as validation, all collection efforts on the part of the creditor must stop or be ceased until you've received the written verification as requested. And again, they have 30 days to provide those documents. Continuing collection attempts after receiving a cease communication notice. This would look like a cease and desist letter. So if you make a written request for the collector to cease communication, legally known as a cease and desist letter, they can only contact you one more time via mail to let you know one of the following. One, that they've received your request and for their efforts to collect the debt are terminated. Note that this does not mean that you no longer owe the debt. It just means that they will not be furthering attempts to contact you about the debt. Two, that certain actions may be taken by the collector. For instance, they can, of course, report this to the credit reporting agencies. They can also file a lawsuit. And third, that the collector is definitely going to take certain actions, such as filing a lawsuit. Something to keep in mind as well, there can be advantages and disadvantages to sending communications to a debt collector or to the creditor, such as the cease and desist letter. On the one hand, if you are extremely stressed out by the number of times that they are contacting you, it's always best, of course, to try to limit or cease those communications as best as possible, because obviously you don't want that stress overtaking your life. On the other hand, when you do send a cease and desist letter, it does mean that you will no longer be receiving information about your file. So you're going to have less information, less notice, and it does potentially speed up or expedite the process or the likelihood that they may file suit against you, since they really have no other way to try and collect at that point in time. So under the FDCPA, you have a right to fair treatment. What that means is that debtors have the right to be treated fairly and respectfully throughout the debt collection process. This includes being free from harassment, threats, and false representations. Again, an example of a false representation would be if a debt collector were to say to you that if you do not respond or you do not pay this debt, then you are going to jail. That would be a false representation. Remedies for violations under the FDCPA. Keep in mind as well that Texas also has its own Fair Debt Collection Practices Act. And typically, if you do find an attorney who is willing to file a lawsuit on your behalf under the FDCPA or Texas's own version, you can typically, I think, select either. One will likely put you in state court in Texas, and the other will likely put you in federal court. So if a debt collector violates the FDCPA, debtors do have legal remedies, including the right to sue for damages, attorney fees, and a cease and desist order. So you do have legal rights and remedies. Again, the best way to protect yourself, though, is always to document everything that you can. So that's providing written notice, maintaining a copy of that. When you are providing written notice, requesting certified mail, return receipt requested to the creditor. That way you have proof that they've received your communication. So validation of a debt. What exactly is debt validation? So debtors have the right to request debt validation, as we discussed earlier. This means that you can ask the debt collector to provide proof that the debt is legitimate and that it actually belongs to you. So what information do they have to provide? When a debtor requests the validation, the debt collector must provide details such as the amount owed, who the original creditor was, and verification of the debt's ownership. So if it's a debt collector or a third-party debt buyer, they would have to verify who actually owns the debt at this point in time and who has the right to recover on it. So timeframe for validation request. Again, debtors typically have 30 days from the initial communication to request debt validation. My recommendation is anytime you need validation, if you're not familiar with the debt, request it, put it in writing. During the time that you do submit the debt validation request, the debt collector cannot continue collection activities. So essentially, those phone calls and collection activities should cease for that 30-day period or until they provide you with the documentation or proof of the debt. Cease and desist communication. So cease and desist, typically it's a letter. It is correspondence. I like to tell people this because sometimes they say, I really need a cease and desist letter. All right, I need a cease and desist to go out, which I'm always happy to assist with. Just keep in mind, it is a sheet of paper. It is a way of documenting your communications and what is going on between you and the debt collector. So it is not necessarily a final order from the court. It is not anything that is necessarily enforceable by, let's say, a police department. It is a letter that is asking the other party to cease their communications with you. As a debtor, you do have a right to stop debt collector communication. And there's even a resource that I've provided a little bit later in the PowerPoint. So it's a website you can go to. I think it's under Texas Law Help, where they have different samples of communications or correspondence that you can send to debt collectors in Texas. So you can send a cease and desist letter to your debt collectors instructing them to stop all communication, and they must respect this request. So how would you actually send a cease and desist letter? To send one, you should use certified mail with return receipt requested. So if you're unsure of how to do that, you can go to your local USPS and they can walk you through that. Essentially, there's going to be two different things that you'll need to add to the correspondence. One is the certified mail receipt, and then the return receipt requested is a green card that typically goes on the back. It's important to keep a copy of the letter for your records. There may be some exceptions to the cease and desist rule that may apply. For instance, the debt collector can respond with specific information or notify the debtor that legal action is imminent. As an example, they can notify you that we've turned this over to a law firm and we are filing suit. So they can notify you that. And then for online resources, I do have some throughout the PowerPoint that you all will have access to. So under here, this is actually the website I was talking about, under guides, and here's the URL that you could go to. They have different resources on this website, which I'm a fan of. And so if you were to click under, it says understanding the law, how can I stop debt collectors from contacting me? Or even should I tell a debt collector to stop contacting me? They're going to have some information there. And then sample letters, you'll see, for instance, here, sample letter, I want the debt collector to stop contacting me. That's in a Word document that they provide, or how to write a cease and desist letter for debt collectors. So they provide some different resources there, which you can utilize. As I mentioned earlier, there are pros and cons of sending a cease and desist letter to a debt collector. So it's important to always research and probably discuss with a legal professional as to those pros and cons and what's the best case in your particular scenario. Okay, so there's also statute of limitations. So I wanted to talk about understanding the statute of limitations on debt. The statute of limitations, it is the legal time limit or time frame during which a debt collector can sue a debtor for the debt owed. And the time limit varies by state and by the type of debt. So I just wanted to point out that there is a difference between a debt remaining on your credit report and then how long it takes before it rolls off, and the applicable statute of limitations in the state of Texas. And I'm not sure if we had a question. Hi there.
No, I was putting the link that you had up there in the chat.
Oh, perfect. Great. Thanks so much. Okay. Okay, so most of you have probably heard before that a debt may not roll off of, or will not roll off of your credit report for 7 years. Technically, it's really 7 years plus 180 days. So essentially 6 months after you've defaulted on the debt plus 7 years, if the debt is still on your credit report, if you've not paid it or reached some sort of settlement agreement in that time frame, it would roll off after that period of time. Additionally, my understanding is that the credit reporting agencies do not give as much credence really to a debt the closer you get to reaching that 7 year or 7.5 year expiration mark. So the debt should start to affect you less and less over time, but of course it can affect you if you're trying to get, let's say, a loan or a mortgage as examples. So debts on the credit report, again, essentially if you default on a debt, let's say today, you don't make a payment and you've defaulted, 6 months from now, what would likely happen is the creditor will likely charge off the account or deem it as not collectible. At that point in time, the debt would still be on your credit report. It's going to show the negative marks for missing those payments each month, and it will not roll off of your credit report until 7 years after that. However, as far as the statute of limitations of when a creditor has to file a lawsuit against you for either breach of contract, suit on sworn account, account stated, there are different causes of action that they can bring, let's say for a credit card, student loans, promissory note, a vehicle, retail installment contract, et cetera. The time frames are maybe a little bit different. Typically, on a normal, let's say, credit card, they have 4 years to bring a lawsuit against you. I will let you know that it's a little murky as to 4 years from which date. Is it from essentially the date that you defaulted, or is it from the charge-off? Creditors cannot charge off the account for at least 6 months from when you've defaulted. That does not mean necessarily, though, that they do charge it off at that 6 month mark. Sometimes it's much longer or later. We make the argument as a debtor defense attorney that the 4 year statute of limitations starts when you've defaulted on the debt. The creditor's attorneys, because there are cases that kind of go both ways, say no, it's from that date of charge off. So it's a little murky there, unfortunately, but essentially just keeping in mind it's around 4 years from when you've defaulted on the debt. If you signed a promissory note, sort of like a note loan, that may be different and that may have a 6 year statute of limitation. So they may actually have longer to bring that lawsuit against you. One thing that a lot of my clients do tend to get confused is the legal or litigation process in a court can take a long time. I always tell people it's a marathon, not a sprint. And the importance of this is let's say we have a creditor who filed a lawsuit against my client in 2020, but we don't have trial in their case until 2023. And let's say my client has said, hey, just keep buying time. I'm not in a good place to settle. Okay, great. So sometimes what will happen is my clients will say, well, why don't we just wait until 2024 to do anything? See if the judge will get it reset to a later date, because once we hit the 4 year mark, I'm good, right? No, the creditor has 4 years to file the lawsuit. Once they file the lawsuit, the clock essentially stops ticking. So if the case gets dismissed, they would still be within that 4 year statute of limitations. But essentially, statute of limitations means that's the legal time limit during which they can sue you. Once they have sued you, then, if the case lasted 6 years before you saw a judge, hopefully it wouldn't on one of these types of lawsuits. But anything is known to happen in the court system. It very well could. That does not prevent them from being able to collect on it, unfortunately. Debtors' right not to be sued for time-barred debt. So debtors have the right not to be sued for debts that are beyond the statute of limitations. If a debt collector sues for such a debt, it's important to raise the statute of limitations as a defense. Unfortunately, what this means is if a creditor makes a mistake and they were to file a lawsuit against you outside of that statute of limitations, that does not mean that you do not need to respond to the lawsuit. Unfortunately, the judge does not know when the statute of limitations is without you bringing that up. And they do not know that you intend to assert statute of limitations as a defense unless you bring it to the court. So you would still be required to assert it to the court, let them know that this is beyond the statute of limitations and the creditor's claim is barred. The judge will then look at the evidence and make a decision, based on the evidence. In my experience, when we've represented clients where this has happened, it has been really just, a mistake or an error that they've made on their end, maybe some negligence as to when the debt originally was defaulted. And typically when we pointed out to them, hey, have you looked at this date? This is the date that you filed the lawsuit. Do you really intend to proceed? Usually they just dismiss the case, but that's after we've already responded to the lawsuit. So implications of acknowledging a debt. I put asterisk here because the law in Texas actually changed in the last few years. In the past, acknowledging a time-barred debt, such as making a payment or agreeing to a new payment plan, could restart the statute of limitations. So this is just a warning, especially if you're not in the state of Texas, you would want to look into your state's applicable laws. Debtors should be cautious about any actions that could extend the time during which they can be sued. Again, Texas, things have changed in the last few years, because our state legislature wanted us to help avoid something called zombie debt. So a zombie debt The notion of a zombie debt, it's basically coming back to life. So it's when debts reach a certain age and they become time barred under the jurisdiction's statute of limitations. So let's say you have a credit card for, CareCredit, and it's been more than 4 years since you defaulted. What this means, once that threshold, that 4 years on that debt is crossed, the creditor, whether it's a debt collector, a third-party debt buyer, or the original lender, can no longer initiate legal proceedings to collect on the debt. However, some unscrupulous debt collectors do seize the opportunity to acquire these time-barred debts at a fraction of their original value. So maybe I know a lot of people say, cents on the dollar. I'm fully aware that many consumers are oblivious to their rights. They are required now, per the changes in the law in the last few years, to indicate to you if the debt is time barred, that this is a time barred debt, and that the creditor does not have the ability or the right to sue you. This does not mean that it comes off of your credit report until you hit that 7 year, 7.5 year mark. And it does not mean that it won't negatively affect you on your credit report, but it does mean that they cannot restart the clock and they cannot file a lawsuit against you. So in the past, taking certain actions, such as making a payment or verbally acknowledging that you owed the debt, could have restarted that clock on the statute of limitations period. So this created a problem called zombie debt, where the time period set out by the statute of limitations could be constantly restarted. So, these debt collectors would call and they would just keep trying to get you to say something or to take some action, even if it was to pay $5 on the debt, to try to reinitiate that time clock. Again, the state law changed in 2019, and it aims to protect people, consumers such as yourselves, from zombie debt. It also requires debt buyers to provide written notice if they're taking action past the limitations period. We've seen that a couple times for my clients this year. They send us notices and they say, "Should I do anything with this?" And the notice clearly indicates this is a time-barred debt. We do not have and do not intend to take any legal action or proceedings, but they are still attempting to collect it. So again, you'll still owe on those time-barred debts, at least until they roll off of your credit report, but the debt collector loses their most powerful way of collecting a lawsuit against you. So moving on to harassment and abuse. So some examples of harassment and abuse by debt collectors, it can take many forms, and we've heard a lot of different things. And unfortunately, some of these debt collectors are not necessarily the most pleasant. I will say being unpleasant is not necessarily a form of harassment or abuse. I would just keep in mind they are doing a job. May not be a fun job for them. They probably don't like it very much, and they probably have people upset with them all the time. However, that does not mean that they have the ability to harass or abuse you. So again, they cannot make excessive phone calls or late night calls. They can't use threatening or offensive language, and they can't publicly shame or disclose the debt to third parties. You do have the right to be free from harassment and abuse by debt collectors, which includes being treated with respect and dignity. So if issues do come up, other than, seeking legal advice, you can definitely report, and I always recommend this to our clients as well. Even though let's say they hire us, we still say, here's where you should also be reporting. So you can report violations of the FDCPA to the Federal Trade Commission, the FTC, and the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, or the CFPB, for investigation and potential enforcement actions. I'd also like to point out that these are two entities that you should also report to if you believe that your identity has been stolen or somebody has fraudulently opened an account, like taken out a credit card in your name. You would want to report that, of course, also to the creditor. You can report it to each of the bureaus individually, but you can also report it to the FTC and the CFPB. The FTC actually has an online affidavit that you can fill out for fraud or identity theft. They typically also recommend that you notify local authorities or the police about the fraud or identity theft. Unfortunately, if it's happened on one account, it is very likely to happen on others. Okay, so communication restrictions. So there's some limits on debt collector contact. They are limited in when and how they can contact debtors. Again, we've gone over this a few times, but they can't call at unreasonable hours. Again, they can call between that 8 a.m. and 9 p.m. period or at your place of work if it's known that that's not allowed or if you've told them you do not want them and prohibited them from calling you there. You do have some rights to set your preferences and boundaries for communication with collectors. So as an example, you can specify times and methods for contact. Typically, the way to do that, you can do it on the phone when they call you, but it's, again, best to put everything in writing. If you do eventually want to bring a claim against a debt collector for violations under the FDCPA, without written proof that you have notified them and that there's been some sort of violation, it's very difficult to prove. So it's always best if you keep, you know, a written record of your notifications to them. So setting boundaries with debt collectors. Debtors should assertively communicate your boundaries with debt collectors in writing if necessary. And again, it's going to be my recommendation. And then keep records of those communications in case a dispute does arise. So right now what I'd like to do is kind of shift gears and talk about, this is sort of past just, you know, the debt collection phase as far as pre-litigation or prior to a lawsuit. If a debt collector has charged off the account, meaning it's been at least 6 months from when, or 180 days from when you defaulted on the debt, they do have the opportunity to file a lawsuit against you in order to try and recover on this debt. Again, they have to do it within the applicable statute of limitations though. So the process of a debt collection lawsuit includes the filing of the original petition. So that's going to be the original document that the creditor files with a court to initiate the lawsuit against you. When they file the petition, usually it will include the creditor's name, not always, but a lot of the time it'll have the debt amount. And if it is a third party debt buyer, it may also include the original creditor. It will also have contact information for the attorneys who are representing the creditor. With that, they will also request for, it's called a citation, and that's necessary in order for them to try and have you served. So they can have you served via, it could be somebody with, let's say, the sheriff's department, or it could be somebody in plain clothes. Typically, when they try to have you served, they will start by making attempts in person. If after a certain number of failed attempts, they are unable to reach you, they may then go back to the court and request for something called alternative service. And that's a request to serve you via an alternative means other than in person. A lot of the time what that looks like is either leaving it in your mailbox or leaving it maybe taped to your front door. So after you've been served, or after you've been made aware, a lot of our clients even hire us before they've been served because they try to get us to accept service on their behalf. So after you're aware of a lawsuit that's been filed against you, the next step would be to file an answer or a response to the lawsuit. We always make sure, as good practice, that we include various defenses. We have a general affirmative defense or a general denial. We also typically include statute of limitations as an affirmative defense, just in case the debt does fall outside of the applicable statute of limitations and is time barred. We also request for something called offsets, credits, and contributions. And what that means is that we're basically saying that they need to provide you with credit for all of the payments that you've made on the debt. After the answer is filed, typically, the next stage when we're representing our clients would be the discovery phase, and that would be the time in which we are working to get the evidence or the discovery from the other side. We want to know what evidence or proof they intend to show to a judge or to a jury to show that the debt was incurred, that you are the correct debtor, and that it is not time barred. After that, we may have various hearings, could be pretrial conferences, could be a hearing on a plaintiff's motion for summary judgment. But typically the next big thing we see is the trial. And most of these debt lawsuits are usually seen in front of a judge. So that is called a bench trial. So you do have a right to defend yourself in a debt lawsuit. I will let you know that I think it's over like 80% of debtors who've been sued in the state of Texas do not file a response or defend themselves in court. What will happen if you do not defend yourself, if you do not file an answer after you've been served, the creditor can then obtain something called a default judgment against you. What that means is that they submit all of their evidence to the court. They say, judge, the defendant or the debtor has failed to respond. We have served them according to the law. They are not in the military, if you are not currently in the military. And we ask that you rule in our favor. Again, if you don't respond, they can get that judgment. That's what a lot of these creditors are hoping for, is that most people will not ever respond. They'll get a judgment. That judgment is good for up to, at a minimum, 10 years. That means they can try and collect on that judgment for up to 10 years, if not longer. They can request for it to be longer from the date that the judgment is granted by a court. Some things they can do with that is they could attempt to garnish bank accounts. They could cloud title on your home, or they could try to sell off any non-exempt assets. So let's say you had a bunch of, like, you know, antique cars, collectibles, paintings, things of value outside of your normal goods and furnishings. So again, you do have the right to defend yourself in court, and you have the right to be pro se, where you're either representing yourself or you may hire an attorney who can represent you. There are also various legal aids and different resources that you can utilize as well through some of the organizations that are actually helping to put on this very presentation today. I also mentioned some of the legal defenses, and we didn't talk too much about counterclaims. There's some strategy behind that as to whether or not you would file a counterclaim in this case, or possibly just file a totally separate lawsuit. Again, if it's under like the FDCPA, it's federal. If they have participated in any harassing or abusive debt collection tactics. But one affirmative defense I didn't mention is fraud. So again, if you are stating that the debt is not yours, or that somebody fraudulently accessed your information and, you know, opened an account in your name or charged your card, for instance, and they were not authorized to do so, then you could also claim fraud. One other thing that we're going to be looking for, this isn't an affirmative defense. It's just an argument to make. And this is usually when we win cases on behalf of our clients, if we end up not wanting to settle. It's usually because the creditor or the third party debt buyer is lacking proper documentation. They do have to prove the original debt. They have to prove that it was yours, that it's within the statute of limitations, all these various things. So sometimes they are definitely lacking that documentation. Other times I will say, because I'm sure some of you have heard it before, is, well, I've heard that the creditor's attorney never shows up in court. I will tell you, sure, that does happen occasionally. In my experience with, and I've handled thousands of these cases, most of the time they do. So I would not really hang your hat on just thinking, well, I don't need to worry about trial because I don't think their attorney will show up. There's a good chance that they will. They've already taken the steps and paid the fees to file the lawsuit. There's a good chance that they're going to move forward and show up in court. So kind of when all else fails, if you're unable to reach any sort of agreement with a creditor or with various creditors, you do have some different options as well. So let's say you have a lot of debt and you just say, there's no way that I'm, you know, my income is going to change and that I'm going to be able to catch up on all of these debts. You do have some options other than just, you know, settling or seeing if they're going to file suit. So for instance, bankruptcy. Bankruptcy for a lot of people really can be light at the end of the tunnel, especially if you have a lot of debt that's accrued and that's primarily consumer or personal debt. So those debts include things like credit card debt, personal loans, medical debt, things of that nature. So one of the, or two of the main chapters or types of bankruptcy that you're looking at when you have primarily consumer or personal debt are going to be Chapter 7 bankruptcy, which is what most people have probably heard of, and Chapter 13 bankruptcy. So under Chapter 7 bankruptcy, in order to qualify, you do need to qualify under the means test. So the Justice Department provides certain amounts for income that a household, based on the number of people in your household, have to be earning under in your state in order to qualify for Chapter 7 bankruptcy. So if you are earning above that amount that has been decided and determined by the Justice Department, Chapter 7 would not be an option for you, and you would likely be looking at a Chapter 13. Under Chapter 7, all of your consumer debts, with a few exceptions, are dischargeable, meaning that those debts will go away, and you do not have to get into a payment plan to pay back those creditors. Some exceptions end up being things such as student loans, which the laws are slowly changing, and hopefully at a rate and in a way that's going to benefit a lot of people who have a lot of student loan debt, child support, and then taxes. Those are things that would not be dischargeable in bankruptcy. And then also, gross negligence or fraud. So if you had a lawsuit filed against you for committing fraud and there is a judgment against you, that would not go away with the bankruptcy. Or if there was gross ne negligence, let's say drinking while driving, and you've now been sued by an insurance company because they're insured, incurred medical expenses, they had to pay for it, and it's been shown that you were drinking while driving, that may also not be dischargeable in bankruptcy. Under Chapter 13 bankruptcy, this is where you would actually go on a payment plan with your creditors. So what they do is they look at your total monthly income and your total debt, and work to come up with a plan. Usually there is going to be a reduction to all of your creditors, but they typically work on, I think, up to like a 5-year plan, to try to get your creditors paid back. So some reasons to consider bankruptcy are, again, really, if you just have so much debt and there's really no way around it. I had a client 1 year, and this is very rare, who literally had no credit card ever, but they had over $300,000 in medical debt, and there was just no way, earning around $20,000 a year, that they would have been able to ever really pay that off in a reasonable period of time, and they were just kind of sinking from that. It was probably, a good option for them, filing bankruptcy in that way. I know a lot of people, you want to take responsibility for your debt, of course. I will say that these creditors have extremely high interest rates, variable rates that you may not be aware of. And a lot of the time, especially in loans, too much money is being loaned out, especially at these high interest rates, that it just sort of sets debtors up for failure, unfortunately. So sometimes bankruptcy is really a good option. I typically discuss the options with my potential clients. Let them know if I think bankruptcy is a good idea for them or not. If we can help them avoid it, great, let's try and do that. But it's really not the worst thing in the world. Okay, so credit reporting and disputes. So what's the impact of debt collections on your credit report? I'm sure as you all know, debt collections can negatively affect your credit report and credit score, which can make it harder to obtain credit or loans. You do have a right to accurate credit reporting, though. So that's accurate and fair reporting of your credit information. Credit bureaus must report information truthfully and promptly. Same thing for the most part with creditors. A lot of the time they enter into agreements with the credit bureaus that says that they it outlines, what information they must share with the credit bureaus. They do have some type of duty to report accurately and fairly as well to the credit bureaus, which is important. And I'll talk about why that's important in a few minutes. So how to dispute inaccurate information, provide guidance. Let me see. You can contact the credit bureaus. You would probably want to contact each of them individually, as they do have some different processes for reporting. Provide evidence and monitor the resolution process. You can typically dispute the debt through the bureaus as well as through the creditor. And one thing I wanted to bring up, because a lot of people have brought this up to me in the past before, it's something that I'm not very comfortable with. It's something called pay for delete or pay for deletion. In the past, it was more common and it was less frowned upon. It is not technically a legal tactic. So I do not personally, for ethical reasons and considerations, being an officer of the court, do not advise my clients on. And I tell them that I cannot negotiate pay for delete. What happens is pay for delete, it's been known as the method of paying and requesting removal of a derogatory marker item from your credit report. In other words, you can offer to pay some or all of the amount owed in exchange for the debt collector removing it from your report. So it's not likely to work with an original creditor, but some third-party debt collection agencies might be more amenable to this process. But the suggestion is don't be surprised if they do refuse, because removing an accurately reported item from a credit report may violate their reporting agreement with the credit bureaus. So a delinquent bill doesn't go to collections right away. Once a bill goes unpaid for a length of time, often around 180 days or that 6 month period I mentioned earlier before they likely charge it off, it's considered seriously delinquent. And then at that point, the creditor is likely to decide if it's worth the time and cost to continually try and collect on the debt. And instead, sometimes they just sell it to a collection agency or to a third-party debt buyer for a fraction of the total amount owed. In turn, that collection agency or third-party debt buyer will take over the debt and attempt to collect the payment from you. So we've already talked about how long a debt would remain on your credit report. The thing, I think I've got more information here on pay for deletion. I will say that there are new credit reporting basically systems or methods that are being used, and the credit bureaus are slowly moving over to that, and so are various lenders. My understanding is that doing pay for deletion wouldn't even help you in these new credit reporting methods that they're moving over to. So instead, it might be a good idea to look at alternatives to pay for delete. So some alternatives are dispute and error. If you do believe that there is an error, you should of course report that. So rather than request for pay for deletion, dispute the error. Another option is you can request that the debt be verified. Again, that would be like the debt validation. The creditor is required to provide proof that you truly do owe the debt in question. Within their first 5 days of contacting you, the collector must provide a debt validation letter, which will state your right to dispute the debt within 30 days. You must do so in writing. After that, the collector must then prove that it owns the debt, you owe the debt, what you owe, and other details. If they aren't able to provide that information, you're not required to pay, or you could dispute the debt. Something to keep in mind, if you never dispute a debt, then essentially the way that the law in Texas works is it basically is you acknowledging the debt and acknowledging that it's yours. So really, best practices is if you ever get a credit card statement and you dispute charges on it or you dispute something on it, it is best to put that in writing, whether you write on the statement and send it back to the creditor and you make a copy of it, or you put something else in writing and you notify them. You should put something in writing. And if you do not dispute the debt, and if you do not dispute the debt after you've received notice that it's in collections, they just assume that you are acknowledging the debt as yours. Another option to try to resolve a debt and see a positive change on your credit report would be to pay the bill. Doesn't necessarily mean the full thing. You may be able to negotiate with the creditor. Something to keep in mind is they likely will not be able to negotiate with you until that 180 days has passed. So again, 180 days from when you've gone delinquent on the debt. So typically, a collection account paid in full reflects better on your credit report. Plus, newer versions of the FICO and VantageScore credit scoring models only ding your credit for unpaid collection accounts. So if you can afford to pay the debt, doing so can save you some hassle, especially if it's, let's say, the only collection account that you do have. I also included some sources here, an article that you could go to from US News. So I just wanted to take a few moments too to talk about the new credit scoring models, which can help minimize collection damage. These will actually affect medical debt the most, because you likely right now don't see medical debt on your credit report. And they're not really going to be considering medical debt. So it's important to note that just because something gets noted on your credit report, this doesn't necessarily mean that it will affect your credit score. In addition, some factors affect your score more than others, and collection accounts are beginning to affect your score less and less. So under these new credit scoring models, such as FICO 9 and VantageScore 4.0, they don't give the same weight to medical collections as they give to other types of collection accounts. Essentially, this acknowledges that medical collections aren't necessarily a sign that someone is irresponsible with credit, which is what your credit score is really supposed to indicate. Additionally, the FICO 9 also completely ignores any collection accounts that are under $100. So they're not factored into your score calculation. That being said, most lenders are still using FICO 8. So you will see these changes take place more and more over time. But FICO 8 is currently still the most widely used scoring model in lending decisions. But there are these newer models that I'm sure eventually will just completely take over. And these will be helpful for consumers and debtors. So some common misconceptions that I wanted to address, because we hear these things from our clients quite often. One thing I hear from people often, actually the first thing I should say that we hear a lot of the time is, well, a creditor isn't allowed to sue me in the state of Texas. This is prohibited by Texas law. I don't know where this came from, but this is a common misconception. I can tell you, I have a law firm that focuses solely on debt defense lawsuits and individuals who are being sued by creditors. We represent lots of clients who have been sued by creditors in this state, and they are absolutely allowed to sue. Additionally, third-party debt buyers are not prohibited from filing a lawsuit in Texas. As long as a third-party debt buyer has applied for a bond with the Texas Secretary of State, essentially a bond indicating that they are a third-party debt buyer, then they do have a right to sue and a right to recover. They essentially step into the shoes of the original creditor and have the same right to recover and to recover the full amount of the debt. Unfortunately, we're not even allowed to request in discovery. I mean, I guess we could, but they don't have to provide it, what they paid for the debt from the original creditor, because it's not really applicable. They do not only have the right to recover what they paid for the debt, they actually have the right to recover the full amount of the debt. Another common misconception is that creditors cannot garnish bank accounts in Texas. If you Google garnishments and checks in Texas, you will likely see that creditors cannot garnish your wages in Texas. That, as of right now, is accurate. They cannot basically put a stop on your paycheck and take those funds directly from your wages or from your paycheck. However, once the funds hit your bank account, they can absolutely file for a writ of garnishment and take the funds from your bank account. There are some exceptions, such as Social Security income and disability. They are not allowed to touch those funds. Something that's important to keep in mind, though, is if you do have various sources of income, let's say you have retirement and Social Security income, and you work part-time, or you have money going into your account that belongs to somebody else. It's really important to kind of keep those separate as best as possible. So I typically recommend that people who have Social Security income, but some other form of income as well, let's say through employment, set those funds into a different bank account, because once it commingles with your other source of income, it makes it easier for them to try and garnish the account, and then you're going to have to figure out how to fight on the garnishment for your Social Security. So just something to keep in mind. Another thing that I hear often is, well, I never got a demand letter, or the creditor didn't reach out to me, X number of times, so they're not allowed to sue me. Unfortunately, this just isn't the case. If there was a debt, if they can prove it, if you defaulted, and if they're suing within the applicable statute of limitations, unfortunately, they can. It may not seem fair, but they can file a lawsuit. We also hear, even if I'm sued, the creditor only has 4 years to go after me, so I'll just wait it out. This is inaccurate. And then once they sue you, if they've sued within that 4 year period, that's what they needed to do, right? They had that 4 years to file the lawsuit. Once they file it, it doesn't matter if the case then extends for another 2 years or 4 years or 6 years. The statute of limitations means that's the amount of time that they have to file a lawsuit against you. So once they file the lawsuit against you, they're good to go. If the creditor has an old address for me, they can't win in court. We hear this a lot. People will look at the statements and say, well, that's an old address. Why didn't they send it to a new one? Typically, I ask this very simple question, which is, did you notify the creditor when you moved and update your address with the creditor? Well, no, I did not. I don't think I've ever had a client say, yes, I did. unfortunately. So, part of the agreements that you sign, usually they will indicate that you do have a duty to keep your information accurate and current. So the duty is actually on the debtor to update your contact information, including a change of address. So if the statements are going to the incorrect address or like an old address, unfortunately, that's not really an affirmative defense. A debt collector threatened me by stating that I will be arrested or go to jail. Now I can sue them. Not saying that you don't have a claim against them. I just wanted to point out, which I know I mentioned earlier, that this likely was not a real debt collector. It is more likely a scam, at least from what I've been seeing over the last few years for my clients. We even had one client where it was a real creditor, like they had the name of the creditor, and she was continuously getting emails from some, fishy-looking email address, and it stated different amounts, and it would say, "Click here to make a payment or call this number." They couldn't verify any of the information. And then she was really scared because they say things such as, "Well, we've got a police officer coming. You're going to be arrested." Again, a debt collector is not allowed to threaten you, and they cannot threaten you in that way. They can tell you that they are filing a lawsuit. That is usually a civil lawsuit, not criminal. So if there's somebody on the phone threatening, saying a police officer is coming to pick you up, you're going to jail. I would say either one, there's a debt collector that is really violating the rules under the FDCPA, or it is a scam. So just wanted to point that out. Usually when that happens, I suggest you hang up immediately. So in conclusion, hopefully we reached our two goals today, which was making sure that you were all more educated on knowing about debt collections and then knowing the importance of knowing what your rights are in debt collections and as a debtor. It's definitely also important to seek legal advice whenever you have questions. There are obviously various resources that are provided through the Houston Bar Association where you can reach out to, let's say, volunteer lawyers program. I've also included some different resources here. These websites, I think, just have good information, the mydebtcollectionrights.org and Texas Appleseed. The FTC.gov website, again, that's going to be, they've got great information too, and that would be one of the websites where you can report fraud or identity theft. So with that, I'd like to open it up to questions. And for anybody interested, I'm also putting my contact information down in the bottom left-hand side of the screen.
Okay. There are no questions on Facebook nor in the chat here. However, there was one that was emailed to me and they asked about HOAs. Can an HOA be considered a debt collector?
Yes, I believe as far as I know, and HOAs, I will let you know, I typically don't even handle HOA collections. I usually refer those out to attorneys who focus specifically on that. If you are being sued by an HOA, let's say for assessments, I think that means that at least 3 years have gone since you've paid your HOA dues. They will check on attorney's fees. Just something to keep in mind, you are likely not going to get a reduced settlement with an HOA. So just something to keep in mind. I will say though, I mean, I would need to look into it to verify. I think that an HOA can show up on your credit report, but I would definitely need to verify that. However, they have a lot of other rights and remedies that they can use, especially because it has to do with your home, right? So you do not want to lose your home over a dispute with the HOA.
Okay. If anybody needs any further assistance about what your rights and things are for an HOA, Lone Star Legal Aid does an HOA foreclosure presentation with us, and so we've got that on that's been recorded. So I can most definitely send that video out if anyone has any other questions or anything about that. When you were mentioning someone could it could be like fraud or a scam. How exactly do scammers get information about your creditors, your debtors, and things like that? Where did they get the information from to even know to target you? Because I've seen a lot of seniors, and even I've got that before, where I'll get a message from what's the the gas company, CenterPoint. Your CenterPoint, your gas service is about to be disconnected if you don't click this link today to pay your bill. I'm like, I know I paid my bill, so how do they even know that I'm, you know, where do they get the information from to even target people?
That's a great question. And I mean, I think there are a lot of different ways. And I think sometimes it's even just guessing. I mean, pretty much everybody has some sort of, I mean, I think everything kind of runs through CenterPoint. So that's just a really good guess, right? For me, I know one of the most common ones that I receive are for either like internet security companies that I don't know, I probably used like 15 or 20 years ago. I don't really remember now though. Or Best Buy is a really common one for me. I'm sure that that has to do with some sort of, you know, data breach and security breach. Sometimes I think it may even be that it could be that maybe they see that there's an active lawsuit, and so then they know your creditor that way. I mean, they're just so sophisticated. It's possible too. There are maybe they have ways to pull your credit report. If they're doing that, then somehow they're gaining access to your information because they would need your social security number in order to pull that.
Another question here in the chat. What are the penalties for a creditor violating the act after 4 years of trying to collect a debt that is time barred? I've heard it was like $1,000 in attorney's fees. So what's the penalty?
So I do believe that those are correct remedies under, let's say, the FDCPA or the same comparable one for Texas. It's not just necessarily though for let's say for trying to collect on a debt that's time barred. I will say anytime that I've pointed out to a creditor's attorney, hey, I think this debt is time barred, they pretty much dismiss it almost the same day. So I think in that scenario, I don't really know that you're going to have a great FDCPA claim because once we've pointed it out to them, they've then dismissed the suit. You could potentially always try. I'm not sure if an attorney who handles FDCPA is going to want to do that though. But that's always been my understanding is I think that there is kind of like a statutory penalty of $1,000 and you can get attorney fees as well. I
What
haven't
do
looked at that in a while though, I'll be honest, because I don't handle FDCPA claims. But that's at least what it used to be.
As far as your cease and desist letters, you said that there were some samples and things that were on that website link. Does the letter have to be, can you do draft your own letter, or does it have to be come from like an attorney's office when you
Absolutely
present them?
not.
Just it does not. Okay.
Oh yeah, you can do it on your own, and those resources online, I've even referred people to it sometimes before because I've said in that scenario, I'm like, look, I don't know that it really benefits you to hire me to send this for you when there is this resource online. I'm not providing legal advice, but there is, you know, this free sample. So I've recommended that to people in the past.
Okay, good deal. Good. All right. What are your thoughts on debt consolidation companies?
So, man, the problem is I have clients reach out to me all the time and say, can you make recommendations for like a good debt consolidation company?
No,
You know, and
no.
unfortunately, oh yeah.
Let me not do that. We're gonna, you know, we're not recommendation or if they're good, if they're not good. Are they reputable? Is it legal? Is it if someone is considering it, is it a viable option? You know, that kind of thing. Because when I heard about it, when one of the financial coaches with Family Houston was kind of explaining it to me, it's like, why would you pay somebody to do this kind of thing when you can just reach out to creditors yourself to try to reach a settlement, as opposed to, you know, and then, you know, not knowing what you're really getting into with a debt consolidation company. So are those legitimate companies?
I mean, they legitimately exist, and I mean, I've known some clients who have definitely gotten, I mean, I say good settlements, or they've gotten some of their debts resolved through them. My concern is that the way that they typically work, is my understanding with these debt consolidation companies, is let's say you have 10 debts and you decide to put all 10 debts into this pool. You're paying them monthly, so they're essentially putting money into an account for you and setting it aside. They will tell you if you haven't already defaulted on your debt, you have to be defaulted at least 6 months. What happens then is once there's enough money in that fund, and mind you, they're charging you a fee as well, right? And I think it's a percentage of what your total debt is. Then they begin settlement discussions with those creditors. In my experience, from my clients have told me, they typically are starting with the lowest balance debts and trying to settle those in a lump sum. So what happens is a lot of people end up coming to me saying, well, I had 10 debts in this plan, they settled two, and now I'm getting sued on my really big debts because they didn't settle those ones. So truthfully, you can settle them on your own. I will let you know, we do some pre-litigation debt settlement for people. I don't particularly like it because it is a lot of work. I mean, it's like running around that we've been sent on so many goose chases before, and you need to talk to this department and this department. No, this creditor or this debt collection agency owns the debt now. No, it was sent to a law firm. The law firm saying, no, we don't have it. We sent it back. I mean, it can take a lot of time. It's much easier once a lawsuit's been filed for us. But truthfully, you can do it on your own. I think it just kind of depends on if you want to go through that and doing it on your own. I personally recommend probably trying it on your own first. I think that just makes more sense because anything that you do, especially when there's not a law, when there's a lawsuit filed, it's different, right? Because you may not understand the law, right? And like how to represent yourself. But before then, I tell people all the time, I'm like, look, unless it's just that you're so afraid and they're so rude to you on the phone that you just really can't handle it. I'm always happy to do it for you, but I would much rather you take that money that you were going to pay a debt consolidation company or a debt settlement company and put it towards the debt, right? Like put it towards the settlement with the creditor.
Yeah, I know that we wanted to make sure that we provided this information to you guys. We know there's a lot of people that are still kind of coming out of the financial hardship or trying to get out of the financial hardship from the impact of COVID. And they're getting a lot of debt collection calls. They're getting, you know, eviction notices and things of that nature. And they're getting a little bit overwhelmed with the holiday season coming up. So we wanted to make sure that this is some information that we present to you guys so that you know what your options are, what the creditors can and cannot do, and then who you can contact in the meantime as well. NRCDC also partners with Family Houston. It is a free financial coaching organization that does give free financial coaching and counseling services if you are interested in talking with one of the coaches there. There are companies that are out there that also charge you to do different things, but like she was saying, similar to the debt collection, that a lot of things that you can actually do and negotiate on your own as well. But at least now you kind of know what your rights are as a consumer as it relates to your debts and things of that nature. So I'm still looking on Facebook. There are no other questions here. I can't believe we only had one question that came up. Nobody has any other questions. This is some great stuff.
I know.
Unless you did a really good job, barely explaining everything already.
I mean, I think it was rather thorough. You may know way more than you ever wanted to, but yeah, I figured this would be the one. This is my third one in the last like month or month and a half, and I expected this one to have the most questions.
Yeah, I did too. So, are there some things that people can do to protect themselves against scammers or creditors? I mean, other than not creditors, but those scammers and things when it comes to somebody trying to, you know, get money out of them that they don't necessarily actually owe?
I mean, as far as scammers?
Yeah.
Oh, man. That's tough. I gave a talk before to a senior education center, and I will tell you, the people who really know a lot about these different scams going on, it is senior citizens. And they, I mean, I went there to teach them, and I told them some very basic stuff, and they really educated me. So there was a lot. I mean, for instance, you know, not tying things to a bank account or a debit card can be helpful. Obviously, keeping your private and confidential information, private and confidential as much as possible, you know, not sending things, you know, over email or on the internet, or if you're on like a public Wi-Fi. I always ask when I get calls or if I get an email, I will call. Like if you say you are from Blue Cross Blue Shield, I will usually just say, let me call back, right? Because I know I have the number. Let me go ahead and do that. Because sometimes I've seen it recently. I've got a good friend, she's in her 80s, and she's like, man, I don't think I've had a T-Mobile account in years, and I definitely shouldn't have any outstanding balance. Well, why don't you just go ahead and verify your mailing address with us? And she happened to be near me when that happened, and I was like, what's going on? And so fortunately, she said, no, I don't think so. I think you should know that, right? If you're trying to collect on this. So I heard somebody else the other day too. It was, somebody from their bank, and they were asking them for information. They were like, no, I'm not going to provide it. Like, I can call back. And the person hung up, right? If it was really a bank representative, is it likely they would hang up? So again, I don't think it's rude at all to say, I'm so sorry, but I really just need to kind of verify who you are and the company. I'm going to call back to the number that I have. I think that's a safe thing to do. One thing I know it's almost gotten my mom several times are those things that say, like you mentioned, like center point, like your gas or your electricity is about to be turned off. That's really scary for people. Again, rather than just react immediately, take a breath, think about it, and then go ahead and contact them yourself, right? Like reach out to the contact information you have for, let's say, Hexa Energy. And say, I need to talk to the billing department. And what do I owe? Just don't ever, sort of willy-nilly give information, even over the phone.
Yeah, I've gotten even that, not just a text message, even over the phone. Their number has been spoofed a couple of times where they say, it's an automated thing and you click this button now to go ahead and make your payment. I'm like, since when did the utility company start calling people asking them to pay their debts and stuff over the phone? I'm like, nah. And it's always been a red flag for me when somebody calls me and asking me to verify information that you're calling me about. It's like, nah, if you're calling me, you should know all of that already. So no, I'm not going to do that. No, thank you. I'll wait. And like you said, I'll call back myself and verify if this is somebody that I actually need to talk to. So 9 times out of 10, they end up not calling back or, hanging up or something like that too. So, yeah, that happens a lot. What happens if the debt collector doesn't provide verification within 30 days?
So again, this is one of those things where you just want to document things. I would, of course, always document any correspondence I send. If I make phone calls to them, repeatedly requesting the debt validation, I've had a handful of clients before say, well, I requested the documents and they never provided it. Do you have any proof that you requested debt validation? And unfortunately, I haven't had one that has. So again, just documenting things is going to be really important. If they still fail to provide the validation, I mean, you may just have a claim under the FDCPA. So you may be able to go after them. You may just be able to dispute the debt. Because again, part of the reason for requesting the debt validation is to determine if the debt is yours. So you may be able to dispute it with the bureaus, with the correct reporting agencies, and then also may have a claim under the FDCPA.
Yeah, a bit of advice that I would also ask for people is, or that I would give to people is to say that know what it is that you're actually trying to do, or what's the goal when it comes to paying your debts. If you're looking to, buy a house or buy a car, I definitely would not recommend that people go in and start kind of fixing things on their own on their credit report, especially if it's a lot of old debt. Because once you start making payments on old debt becomes new debt, and it restarts that 7 year clock again. So reach out to your lender or whomever it is, and let them tell you what it is that you need to pay off or get rid of or pay down or what have you on your credit report before you actually start going in there and doing that kind of thing. Because sometimes that can actually hurt you and even drop your credit score even further, considering, again, when old debt becomes new debt, it does drop your credit score. So you want to be careful about that. And even when you're entering into those payment arrangements with some of these collection agencies, get it in writing. Most definitely ask if they're asking you to pay something or asking for a settlement or something like that, get it in writing. And then, are they going to report it? How are they going to report it to the bureaus after that? Is it going to be reported as paid or reported as a charge off or reported as, however it is it's going to be reported, you need to know what the end result is actually going to be when you're talking to those collectors too. Let me see if there's anything else in here.
I
That
know
is
one thing
it.
I just wanted to bring up while you're searching for it is, so I mean, there are a lot of recommendations out there. The goal, of course, is to try not get in the situation in the first place, right? So obviously,
Absolutely.
paying your debts on time, but also, I mean, really look at your financials. And like the thing that I never really get, especially with like hard money lending and like payday loan places, is the only way that it usually works, where it's like maybe for 30 days there's like no interest or very low interest, but then all of a sudden, I mean, it just catapults. So the only way that it really works is if you do know that you just need those funds for a short period of time to get you over some hump, but you're going to have kind of an influx of money. So, and I know it's hard because sometimes it's like I got to do what I got to do and I need to get food on the table for my family and I've just hit rough times. But you still need to think long term as well, because how much worse is it going to be when you end up having to make these huge payments back to the creditor? So unfortunately, the way that our credit system here works, I mean, creditors are very predatory. My clients who file bankruptcy are getting loan applications, credit card applications right after the bankruptcy is done and over with, because they know they can't file again for another 8 years. So it's just a matter of, educating yourself. There are credit counseling courses out there. It
Yes,
is
sir.
tough, especially, and I say this all the time. Because I know you were talking about generational wealth, I would have loved to have really, I mean, like, I knew how to balance a checkbook. I knew how to write a check. These things that we learned when we were younger that they may or may not teach at all anymore.
No.
But that didn't mean that I was told how to actually manage a budget. Like, what do I actually do? Look at what's coming in, what's going out, look at these interest rates, and kind of read the small print, because a lot of these loans and things, I mean, they're going to get you and put you in a really bad spot. So ideally, you can just avoid it. I'm not saying all credit is bad. I mean, credit cards, especially with points and stuff, can be fabulous. But it's obviously best if you're pretty much able, like if you know, hey, I can afford to pay this off each month.
Well, and then it's not to look at credit or an extension of credit or access to credit. It's not money. People think that they have extra cash when it's or extra money when it comes to credit, not realizing that that's you're just borrowing against money that you may have in the future that you need to pay actually pay back. So if you've got a $5,000 limit on a credit card, it does not mean that you have an extra $5,000. You have access to a line of credit that you do have to pay back with interest. So definitely keep that in mind.
Exactly.
We actually have we try to tell people about being conscious of how it is that they spend their money and where they spend their money. Because a lot of times, especially now with the holidays coming up, we just had our holiday spending financial workshop last week. And people get into the habit of just like swiping their card or getting an upgrade at Starbucks or adding an extra whatever, things like that, and not really paying attention to how they actually spend their money. They just become in the habit of just swiping and going and things like that, and they don't, you're not really conscious. It just becomes habit. But you really need to be just conscious and aware of where and how you're spending your money. So we developed or put or branded what we call our 30-day bag challenge. So we have these gallon-sized Ziploc bags that has instructions on the outside of the bag. This is 30-day bag challenge where you put all of your bills, all of your receipts for everything that you spent in that bag for an entire 30 days. And at the end of the 30 days, take it out and add it all up and see where exactly or how it is that you're spending your money. So that way you can kind of be aware, oh my God, I'm spending $50 a month at Starbucks or $50 a week eating out to eat for lunch, as opposed to trying to okay, well, maybe I won't, go to Starbucks 5 days a week. I'll only go four. And then kind of, figuring out what you can do to save that money or that difference that you're paying and put it towards something else. So it's just a matter of also being conscious of how your money is being spent and where you're spending it so that you don't get caught where you're a little bit short 1 month, where you got $3,000 worth of receipts in this bag, but you only bring in $2,500 a month. You got to figure out where's that other 500 bucks is coming from. How am I spending this money that I don't have? So just kind of being aware of that. So if there's anybody that's interested in any of those 30-day bags, those Ziploc bags, and I'll be happy to send those out to anybody. It's great for the kids to be conscious and aware of, to kind of get them started a little bit early about how they actually spend their money, because they think that their parents are, the modern day ATMs that can just kind of get money, don't pay attention, don't get allowances and things of that nature. They just think that they can, Cash App me, Zelle me, or whatever, and just keep spending. So get the kids involved at an early age with being conscious about their money too, and how debt actually works. I believe that is it. I don't think I have anything else. If anybody else has anything else to add, or anything else that they'd like to say about their experience with debt collections or anything like that, please feel free to kind of chime in. But Megan, I want to thank you very much for the information that you presented here. All of the links that you provided for the resources, I will be emailing out to everyone for them to go back and do a little bit more research on, as well as a link or a copy of this recording for people to go back and watch as well. So we ask that you share this information with other family members or neighbors or coworkers or whomever may also find this information to be beneficial. You can also always just watch on our Facebook page or on our YouTube channel, where we're going to have this information uploaded as well. So with that being said, thank you very much. Thank you for all of our participants for joining us this afternoon. We'll give you the last half hour of your afternoon back. Thank you very much, Miss Grace. Thank you, Mr. Cruz. We haven't seen him in a while. Thank you for joining us this afternoon. Miss Nikita, I see you on the line too, Miss Monica. Thank you guys very much. We all appreciate your participation with a month of service collaboration. We hope to see you again in the future, and we want to again just thank you for your participation and your support of our collaboration. And hope you all have a wonderful remainder of your afternoon. Megan, again, thank you very much, and you take care of yourselves, and you all be safe.